CEO's.
Okay, let's resume after the break. This is the Public Accounts Committee public hearing, and I suppose Mr. Edmund Wong, we completed part 3, is that right? So we now start with part 4. Mr. Edmund Wong, the lead member, please walk us through about footbridges. But I still have one more question about part 3, Chair. Right, a question on part 3, all right. Thank you, Chair. 3.20B. Contractor B was entitled to an extension of time of 514 days and a prolongation cost of $4.8 million associated with the delay to Section 8. But according to Note 37 or Note 36, the contractor was entitled to the extension of time and the prolongation cost, but may I know under what circumstances a claim could be made out in relation to the EOT director? There are clauses in the contract spelling out the specifics, but off the top of my head, I can't recite them now. Simply put, the clause is about allowing an extension of time but not additional expenditure. I'm afraid I can't tell you off the top of my head at this moment. Perhaps I can supplement this information later. Thank you, Chair. The administration can give us a written reply later. 3.21. When vetting consultant-wise assessment of claim A in March 2019, the CDD reminded consultant Y that the prolongation cost entitlement under claim A should be related to Section A, so on and so forth. But in replying to audit's inquiries this year, the CDD said that the prolongation cost of $4.8 million granted to contractor B was not solely for the landscape software works and establishment works for footbridge A under Section A. And why is it that there seems to be a conflict between the two answers? You first said that it is not included, and then you said otherwise. Director, my understanding, according to the papers, is that it's not included. Consultant Y provided some documents to support his assessment for the CDD to make comments, and the CDD then pointed out and asked whether this was only due to the establishment works and landscape soft works and or otherwise. Now, the reply was just noted, but in fact the $4.8 million included other factors for consideration. Now, like I explained before, if Consultant Y was able to give a more detailed response explaining that they already took into account other factors for consideration, this would be more ideal. Mr. Wong, I think at the outset, the director explained about the gap between Chinese and English version of the word meaning fence or hoarding. Or perhaps the director of audit adopted a different definition. And according to, now on this point, the consultant Y replied by saying noted, and I think this has to do with the same issue. Is it that because of insufficient written correspondence, misunderstandings arose? Yes, in the future, I will remind my colleagues to step up communication. Mr. Wong, is that all? Other members, any more questions on part 3? If not, then Mr. Wong, you may proceed to part four. About part 4.3b, about the management and maintenance of 17 lifts for the footbridges, and 4.3b states that the suspension of lift services range from 6 minutes to 242 hours, that's 10 days, averaging 10 hours. So that's a rather prolonged period of lift suspension. Now the footbridges and the lifts are supposed to facilitate residents, and there are 17 lifts. Is there a performance pledge for the maintenance and repair of lifts? By how long should lifts be repaired? Because otherwise residents living up Anderson Road won't be able to reach Sao Mau Ping. Secretary. Let me invite Mr. Pang, Director of Electrical and Mechanical Services, to take this question, please. Mr. Pang Yu-Hong. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Wong. The EMSD attaches great importance to safety and reliability when it comes to maintenance of lift services. Now, there are 17 lifts that matter a lot to residents in Po'on Po'tat Estate residents. We attach importance to repairing lifts. Now, to answer members' question on 4.3b, the duration of suspension ranged from 6 minutes to 242 hours, averaging 10 hours according to this report. So that's the summation of all the durations in the incidents and the average. Now, according to Table 7, 67% of suspension lasted 6 minutes to 3 hours. So the median duration is within 3 hours. 67% had suspension for 6 minutes to 3 hours. But the average hour, the average duration may be longer because of some particular instances in which duration of suspension was longer. Now, performance pledge within 1 day, but in fact, repairing a lift within 3 hours is still reasonable. After receiving a call, our repairman will need to attend the scene, followed by inspection, changing of parts, testing of lifts, and we believe a 3 hour duration is reasonable. And there is also a distinction. Let's say if somebody is trapped in the lift, then it may take longer than 3 hours. These lift incidents are commonplace in Hong Kong, but if somebody is inside the lift, then regardless of the location of a lift incident, regardless of the location of the repair company concerned, the repairman should reach a scene within 30 minutes. Then that's an important requirement. In other words, the relevant companies should set up stations at strategic locations in Hong Kong so that they can reach the locations in question in 30 minutes. And we keep track of the time needed for lift repair and time required for arriving on scene to ensure that they can abide by our requirements. Now, I really want to praise the director because I'd wanted to ask about the performance pledge, the time needed to arrive on the scene, and he answered all the questions. He also answered the average of 10 hours. That's because of some particular incidents. with prolonged period duration of suspension. Now, we have a lot of lifts in Hong Kong. Does the EMSD keep parts frequently used in lifts so that we can skip the procurement process, allowing immediate repair of faulty lifts? And about the lift which took 10 days to be repaired, may I know what happened? Director. Thank you, member, for the questions. First, about the case in which 10 days were required, and second, about the spare parts in our inventory. In a case which required 10 days for a lift to be repaired, now the suspension ropes of the lift had become rusty. Despite the lift still functioning, having discussed with the contractor, we believe the suspension ropes should be replaced. The suspension ropes are usually made of steel, but instead of having a round shape, it's a flat. Well, it's a set of red flat ropes in this particular lift, and that's because of the limited space available in the lift shaft, and this is not a typical design of the lift. And territory-wise, the contractor couldn't find the ropes in the inventory that could meet the standard length. Now, for overseas procurement had to be done. Now, originally, 7 days would suffice for the delivery of parts and installation. But because of the problem I mentioned, it took more than 7 days. And as a result of the unsatisfactory performance, we issued two warning letters to the service contractor to show our dissatisfaction towards. And because of this report, it will have a bearing on the future tendering exercises. About the keeping of the contractor is required to provide monthly information of and because of this incident, apart from submitting monthly reports on important spare parts, we reviewed others spare parts that could, are not generic, and that they are required to keep these spare parts in their store, and our staff also conduct inspections of the store. In other words, after the incident, we have become more stringent in checking the spare parts inventory to prevent a repeat of this incident. Mr. Wong, Chairman, I think the EMSD has given us a comprehensive reply and addressed a lot of my concerns. Now, Note 3 of Table 7, in June 2020, a lift at footbridge B was suspended for 177 hours or 7 days because of flooding. Now, these lifts are installed outdoors and they are subject to the elements. Was it really because of flooding? Because otherwise, why did it take so long to repair the lift? Director, thank you. On the 6th of June 2020, the black rainstorm signal was hoisted, a warning signal was hoisted, and this lift at Anderson Road was situated at the mid-level, and on the land platform and at the mid-level of Anderson Road, there was heavy downpour together with a service runoff that came with debris. And the lift was flooded as a result. Since rainwater also carried debris along, A lot of time was needed to clean the lift before it was recommissioned. In fact, after the incident, we reviewed with the department in terms of the drainage arrangements so that if something like this happens again, the rainwater can be diverted to in a way to avoid flooding. And in fact, after the 6th of June 2020, we haven't encountered another similar incident. But have you reviewed the design of similar lifts such that if another black rainstorm warning signal is hoisted again, there would be sufficient drainage capacity to help us avoid another lift suspension? Let me invite the Highways Department to talk about the review. Mr. Chen Wai Tech from Highways Department, thank you. Yes, Chief Highway Engineer, Mr. Chen Wai Tech, please switch on his mic. Thank you, Chen. Thank you, Mr. Wong, for the questions. On after the 6th of June 2020, we reviewed the whole incident to look for a cause. There was a heavy downpour in Kowloon East, and especially near Chao Phraya River. There was also the spilling of overflow at the, of Chao Phraya River. And at Footbridge B, we erected some boards to avoid the flooding of lift tower, and we've also implemented drainage improvement measures. In fact, for footbridges A, B, C, D, we have implemented improvement measures for the collection of rainwater. Anything to add, Director? No? Then Mr. Wong. Para 4.4. We talked about malfunctioning of lifts at the footbridges. Is it normal wear and tear within a 3 or 5 year period, as you've stated in the report, or is it that the wear and tear was particularly serious for these lifts because of the locations they were situated? For lifts at footbridges, they are unique in the sense that they are used by the general public. In the Anderson Road scenario, the lifts are used very frequently, round the clock. The other factor is an external factor. Although the lift is installed at underneath the footbridge, it is a semi-open style, and that is similar to lifts installed elsewhere for other footbridges. For example, the lift towers are made of glass, and the lifts, and inside the lifts, therefore the temperature is quite high, and they are more susceptible to humid weather. And there are also debris, fallen leaves, that may affect the operation of lift doors. We compared these 17 lifts with other lifts of the Highways Department for footbridges and subways, and we compared the wear and tear of the lifts and the replacement rate of parts, and basically the situation is similar.
Mr. Edmund Wong, so can I put it this way? For Footbridge A, its lifts, frequent repairs were needed. More people use the lift, so more repairs were needed. So it's not the case that the lifts there broke down more frequently. Or do all these 17 lifts come from the same supplier? They belong to two brands, that is the lift. They are common brand names in the lift. For the lift at footbridge A, more cases of breakdown were reported. This has to do with external factors. So this is not about the equipment failure. This has to do with the litter, the leaves, or improper use of the lift. In short, external factors. Or in some cases, people reported a case of malfunctioning when the lift was actually working. All these factors led to a higher rate of reported malfunctioning for the lift at footbridge A. This leads to the impression that the lift at footbridge A broke down more frequently. But the lifts there at footbridge A were used more frequently. I believe the usage is one factor behind this number. And this also explains why more frequent repairs were needed for the lifts at footbridge A. You mentioned two brands for the lift. So we're talking about one brand for A and then another brand for B to D. So you're saying A to C, that's one brand, and then the lift at D, they belong to another brand. You mentioned a non-standard suspension rope, the flat one. Which lift used that suspension rope? That's the lift at footbridge A, Mr. Edmund Wong. So now we know the lifts at footbridges A to C belong to one brand. More people used footbridge A and the lift, so more repairs were needed for the lifts there. Footbridge D, subsequently built, was next to footbridge A. Even then, usage of the lift at footbridge A was higher. At first, there was skepticism about the need for a footbridge D. What made the government think footbridge D would be enough for entire estate and the quarry site? Ms. Winnie Ho or Mr. Michael Fong, who's going to take the question, please? Mr. Wong, Mr. Max Wong, Assistant Director of Housing, will tell us more. For footbridge D, it was built based on our plan. It's around the middle of Ontai Estate. It's close to the bus terminal and close to the market. More people around that area, so we consider that spot to be suitable for a lift tower. The lift can also connect to Sama Ping Estate. Mr. Edmund Wong, footbridge D diverted some of the people to the bridge, but even after that, footbridge A saw a high usage level. At first, it was thought that three footbridges would do. Local residents asked for a fourth footbridge, but the government saw no such need at the tendering stage. Finally, a fourth footbridge was added. So there has been a need for a fourth footbridge all along. Is this the case, Mr. Max Wong? Indeed, this is right. Anything from you, Ms. Winnie Ho? Or Ms. Agnes Wong? Anything from you, Director of Housing? Uh, as we said at the last meeting, we did the traffic review study. That was back at the time when the estate wasn't meant to be fully public housing. And then after we decided this would be a solely for public housing, we had to look afresh at the layout. We took on board the comments from the district council. And we subsequently we did a study on the traffic, on the distribution, the location of the pedestrian flows. And then we came to the conclusion that we needed a fourth pedestrian footbridge. This was the result of us taking on board the comments we received and the outcome of the study on pedestrian flows. Thank you. Anything from you, Ms. Winnie Ho? Nothing from me. Thank you. Mr. Edmund Wong. Chair, here's the story. At first, it was a public-private partnership. It was thought that three footbridges would do. There was an environmental impact assessment and then a traffic impact assessment. And then there was a change of plan. The site would be used for public housing alone. And then the government relied on the first report to build three bridges, even though it was aware that three would not be enough. And then the government listened to the local residents and decided to build footbridge D. Shouldn't the government have adopted a four footbridge plan instead of making changes afterwards, leading to higher costs? Anything from you, Ms. Agnes Wong? Nothing from me. There was a change of plan to do public housing only on the site, and the site would be 100% public rental housing. So we had to look afresh at the layout of the buildings, and we had to study where to put the bus stop. We considered a basket of factors, and that warranted a traffic review study later on. And the outcome of that study was to have a fourth footbridge. During local consultations, we took on board the comments and decided to make changes to the three existing footbridges and then add a fourth one. So this is what happened, Mr. Edmund Wong. The lifts at the footbridges break down fairly frequently. People need all these lifts to get around or visit the Sanwaping area. For the EMSD and the Housing Department, what can be done about the lift? Are lessons learned about these lift breakdowns? What can be done to prevent frequent breakdowns? First, we will hear from Mr. Peng from the EMSD, and then we will hear from the Housing Department. Mr. Peng, Director of Electrical and Mechanical Services. We have taken measures to step up monitoring of the contractor to ensure safety, reliability. Here are some measures. First, special inspections. Under the law, there has to be a maintenance exercise at least once per month, and then there has to be an inspection per year. Now, our requirement is to do weekly checks, and then every year, a full inspection is needed. So we are going beyond the statutory requirement. The EMSD also requires an independent inspection. So we engage an independent engineer to conduct a special check on the lift. It's like an audit. To check the condition of the lift. Our colleagues also do spot checks for routine checks and annual inspections. We also regularly review the inventory level of spare parts. Every month, we look at the stock level. When needed, we visit the warehouses of the contractors to see if they have as many parts as they report. The third measure, remote monitoring system. This is about using technology. When flooding or false alarms are detected, the situation would have been communicated to the contractor in the past, but now our colleagues will be alerted. The number of incidents reported and the time the contractor needs to get to the scene the problem is fixed in full. For repairs, we put out notices to let the residents know when maintenance or repairs will happen. Off hours are picked for the scheduled repairs. When extended maintenance is needed, notices are put out to let residents know. The district councillors will also be informed. So that the district councillors can explain to the residents why a suspended maintenance session is needed. Now, we also do a digital log for the lift. Since December last year, for all these 17 lifts, we have adopted a digital log. This is a blockchain-enabled log system. EMSD officers arrive at the scene, they enter the details of the lift and enter the repair result. Three parties can monitor the result. First, the management of the lift contractors. Second, the government department. For ordinary lift, the incorporated owners of a building can be involved. The highways department is also involved. The EMSD is also monitoring the situation. In cases of frequent repairs or when there are scheduled weekly repairs, but there are delays in the start time and the end time affecting usage, we can do big data analysis to see if certain lifts require more frequent repairs. For some lifts, we have also installed a device for preventive maintenance. This means installing sensors and technology involving the Internet of Things. The devices can tell whether the temperature in the lift is too high or whether there is excessive vibration in the lift doors. This means early alert before the lift breaks down. This will help preventive maintenance to prevent the lift from breaking down. We promote greater use of technology, the use of innovative technology. We explore creative solutions to monitor lifts and escalators. And we spare no effort in this area of work. Thank you, Mr. Peng. Ms. Winnie Ho. Just then, there was a question about the footbridges. future assessment and current monitoring of usage. I know the Transport Department has been doing some work. Ms. Rosanna Law, the Commissioner for Transport, will take the question. There is enough capacity as long as the lifts work. Mr. Pang has also mentioned a range of measures. They will also help for the lifts at Footbridge A and at Footbridge B and D. Some lifts are used more often than the others. For Footbridge A, the bridge is close to where people do their shopping or community facilities. This means a higher surface demand for the lifts at Footbridge A. So we're doing two things. First, more frequent bus services. In the past, the Kwantung District Council was against providing transport linkage all the way to Kwantung for fear of transport overload. But now the district council there is more receptive to the idea of extending the transport linkage to Kwantung. This means residents will get more options. They can hop on public transport to get to Kwantung. That means fewer, less need for the lift. On Shun On Road, we also plan to add 619, 619X and 619X bus stops. The work will be completed this quarter. More buses going past Footbridge D will also mean less demand for the lifts at Footbridge D. We will also put up signs on Onyan Street to divert the people to Footbridge A or Footbridge D. The walk takes roughly the same time. More people prefer Footbridge D, especially after there's a new bus stop at Footbridge D. With 619, 619X and 619P and new bus routes to be done in Footbridge 1 and Quad in the first quarter, we've also put out the signs in the first quarter. So all these measures will help divert people from Footbridge A. Thank you, Ms. Ho. Anything from you, Ms. Agnes Wong from the Housing Department? Mr. Edmund Wong. I thank Ms. Law for her information on the new bus route. These are the new bus routes, buses that will stop at Footbridge D. So more people will use Footbridge D. Is it the case that many people go to Footbridge A and then they take the lift there to get to higher ground? Ms. Law, we visited the area. The walk from Footbridge A to the bus stop is similar to the walk from Footbridge D to the bus stop. But then for Footbridge A, you're going downhill. There are seniors living in the housing estate, and there are also women living, housewives living there. They may prefer taking the downhill route. So now we want to add more bus routes to Footbridge D so people no longer have to walk uphill, so that may get people to take the bus near Footbridge D.
Hey.
Mr. Wong, so on the on one side, you're talking about people having to walk downslope, but then going to Shunlei, that's the terminus, so it means that people will have to walk uphill. So will there be another footbridge so that people can just use that footbridge, or are you expecting people to use that only for central bound routes? Well, from Shunlei to Central, well, more people would be using the bus stop at Footbridge D. So there is a need for us to make improvements there. But then on the other side, there is less need for further improvement. But then we can also see that during busy peak hours, some routes, some bus routes will be going to Kwantung downtown. So can that also be used so that people can use that stop to go to Kwun Tong Town Center, so that instead of going to Sam Mau Ping, they can also go straight to Kwun Tong for shopping and other activities. And if representatives from Kwun Tong support that, then we can sort that out with the bus operator. We are actually talking to them. Mr. Wong, yes, I'd like to clarify. You said that people can go to Kwun Tong for shopping. So are you talking about a new route or are you referring to 619? Because it's quite expensive crossing the harbour. It's the fare is over $11. Yes, we're talking about 213A and 213B, and then 619 is the cross-harbour route and therefore is more expensive. So Mr. Wong was correct. Okay, in the audit report, well, we are talking about lift management, but then somehow members are also very concerned about people's livelihood. And I think the transport department has been well prepared for all sorts of questions. Yes, Mr. Wong. Yes, from the WHC. Well, with the additional service of 619, there are more people using Footbridge D. So I have another question. Yes, it's an uphill route, and you're trying to reduce the need for people to walk uphill. So are there pedestrian crossing facilities so that people can take the lift up to the footbridge again? Yes, Ms. Law, Commissioner. Well, last time when I was there myself, well, I don't have the information with me now, but then I remember there was indeed a crossing, so I was able to cross the road there. And if there isn't, then we can consider introducing one. Yes, I'm sure the commissioner was there, and you can see that we have a bus stop there, but then you will have to make sure that it's easily accessible, and therefore you will have to have pedestrian crossing facilities. And of course that would also depend on the utilization rate, so that you can also reduce the loading on pedestrian footbridge A. And then 4.10, you said that Anderson Quarry, that is above On Tai Estate, there is another housing project, and you expect to have another 30,000 people moving in. So let's not forget that for the entire Anderson Quarry project, you have forecast to have 48,000, but then it's going to be even bigger. So with 30,000 more near On Tai Estate, so have you made any assessment? So what is the pedestrian flow like on footbridge A and B? To what extent would that add to the pressure of both footbridges? What more improvements can be made to make sure that they can sustain it? So because the population intake date is very close, Bureau Director, I'll ask the CEDD to tell you more about the assessment on Anderson Road and nearby roads. Yes, Chairman. For the pedestrian linkage system, because of the Anderson Quarry and also the housing projects nearing completion and ready for population intake, we have put in place 12 clusters of footbridge system in order to ensure that people can be connected or can access Kwun Tong and the surrounding areas. Well, in terms of the Anderson Quarry site, there are six projects being built. One would be connecting the existing footbridge B. On another side, there is another group connecting with footbridge C. So there are three lift towers. There are three sets with 8 to 10 lifts working together. So with regard to the Anderson Road Quarry, coming down to On Tai Estate and On Tai Estate, and then to the other areas, our assessment is that these should be adequate. So that's all I'd like to add. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Wong. All right. Coming to the final part, this is my last question, 4.18D. It says that upon completion for the post-completion review, well, it should be within a reasonable period of time, say 6 months after the completion of the project. I'd like to know. Okay. It's almost 5.5 years after the completion of the project. And in some other cases, you have completed the project and yet you have not completed the post-completion review. Why has it taken so long? Well, Director, I admit that concerning the Anderson Road project for the post-completion review, we have been quite tardy in completing the review. Initially, we said that upon the completion of the project within 2 years, we should complete the post-completion review as well. So I admit that we haven't done a very good job here. And after reading the audit report, I took it very seriously because I was wondering, what are the projects under the CEDD? So have we been able to do timely post-completion review? We did that review already, and as of today, we have already completed all the post-completion reviews concerning all the completed projects, and I can also undertake that for from now on. We would have to make sure that all such reviews will be completed in a timely manner, and I myself as the director, well, once every 2 or 3 months, I would be talking to the branch offices' heads. We would have regular meetings, and then I would put it as a regular agenda item. That is for post completion reviews. They will have to be completed in a timely manner, and I would make sure that it would be part of our standing item. Okay, I have no further questions. So, concerning Footbridges ATD, any further questions from the other members? Yes, Louis Long. Chairman, my question has partly been answered, but then part of that has not. What I mean is that the administration has already answered part of the question asked by Mr. Wong, and that has already covered part of my question. Well, also, under para 4.2, note 38, well, CEDD, in accordance with four contracts for the maintenance of lifts and lighting works of Footbridges ATD, that has been outsourced to contractors under four contracts. So, for Footbridges ATD, well, for the lift system, so, was it the original suppliers responsible for the maintenance works as well, or has it been outsourced to other contractors who are not the original suppliers of those lifts? Yes, Director. Well, we do encourage competitive bidding, and therefore, starting from several years ago, we have already opened up maintenance works to all registered lift contractors. But then for every contract, well, for the number of lifts included, well, we only have one single brand, because I think there's some feedback from the sector. If you have too many brands, then some contractors would only know how to do maintenance works for a particular brand but not the others, and in some cases they may not be able to service some different brands. So we only have one brand. So when it comes to lift towers under Footbridges A, B, and C, there are three different contracts. And then at the end, well, out of the three contracts, two were done by the original manufacturers. And then for the other one, the one winning the contract was not the original manufacturer of the lift. But then we also paid special attention to the scoring criteria. So for contractors who are not the original manufacturer, their competency would also be considered. well, how do they keep the spare parts and so on? So those would also be considered or given weighting. So for the maintenance performance of the contractors, well, on the face of it, you might think that they are not of the original manufacturer and therefore the quality of service might be affected, but then in reality, that's not the case. Okay, opening up the market is a good thing. And therefore, my next question is, I don't really mind if it's done by the original manufacturer or not, because whoever has been engaged as our contractor, I think there's their quality of service and performance should be kind of ranked five-star contractors, right? So do you have a scale of contractors? Well, for the five-star contractors, according to Mr. Long, well, the enforcement unit of the EMSD, well, they would also score or rate the lift maintenance contractors, and safety performance would also be given 1 star. So either they have 1 star or they don't. So in terms of the scoring criteria, so when they put in their bids, when we consider whether or not they should be given the contract, their safety performance, whether or not they get the star for that part will be considered. Okay. My next question is about 4.3B. Well, it says that from January 2019 to December 2021, so you're talking about a 3-year period, well, for the suspension of lift services at footbridges A to D, there were a total of 143, and these are lifts that have been in use from 3 to 5 years, and for equipment failure, well, that has reached some 78%. And then on the most right hand side of the column, you can see that for the average number of cases, well, for footbridge A, it far exceeded footbridge D. So in terms of suspension, footbridge D has experienced a lower level of suspension, and you said that that might have to do with the high utilization rate for footbridge A, because the utilization rate for footbridge A has been a lot higher. But then other than utilization, the lift itself, because footbridge A and D should be using different brands of lifts, is that correct? So for footbridge A and D, would the differential quality of the lifts has anything to do with the suspension rate? Well, let me respond to that first. Just now, mention was made about the breakdown rate for footbridge A, and there are 2 reasons. One, high utilization. Second, some external factors. For example, the users sometimes might have pressed the wrong button, and in the outdoor area, sometimes there might be garbage, leaves and so on left in the lift, resulting in higher failure rate. But then when we looked at the situation, it has basically nothing to do with the brands of the lifts, because for footbridge A, B and C, they are of the same brand, and for footbridge B and C, the breakdown rate is not that high. So I believe that the 2 factors that I just referred to should have an impact. But then we are not suggesting that that is acceptable, because we will continuously monitor the performance to ensure that the failure rate will come down and the utilization rate can go up. I think it's a good thing to continuously monitor the situation. My last question is about 4.10A and also note 44. It says that the CEDD and the Transport Department separately did a traffic survey for footbridges A and B. And then, according to what is said here, the pedestrian flows have been very smooth, and yet there is room for improvement in the lift services in order to reduce the lift waiting time. In other words, pedestrian flows have been affected by the bottleneck in the lift services. So my question is, how come the traffic surveys were limited to footbridge A and B? What about footbridges C and D? Have you conducted similar traffic surveys? Yes? Director, because we are responsible for maintenance of the lifts and therefore traffic surveys were not within our purview. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. Okay, we'll try to find out more. Yes, Commissioner for Transport, Ms. Law. Thank you, Chairman. Well, the traffic survey that we did was on footbridge A and B because the two footbridges were more popular with the residents from the two estates, and of course the highlight is on footbridge A because it's most popular. And as is said here in the report, footbridge A, we have actually conducted a 7-day survey during peak hours. Well, pedestrian flows had been smooth, but then during peak hours, the waiting time was relatively long. For example, during the morning peak hour, people may have to wait for up to 7 minutes. So there is room for improvement in the lift service. And one of the things that we can do is to reset the program so that we can find ways to make sure that they can better suit the needs of the residents, because during the morning peak hours, inevitably people might have to wait for a while, but then whether or not they have to, they can run simultaneously, or once people press the button, they can go, they can move up or down more easily. And also during the peak hours, whether or not it can be switched from the auto mode to the on-demand mode, that also make a difference. So that would also help reduce the waiting time. So we'll be working with the relevant department so that during school holidays we can make the change so as to provide greater convenience to the users. Next, Mr. Louis Long, does that mean that the department is happy with the current pedestrian flows for footbridges C and D, because you've only completed traffic surveys for footbridges A and B? Well, Commissioner, according to my observation for footbridges C and D, the utilization rate is relatively low. For example, for footbridge C, for the per hour usage is 1650. And according to the actual observation, it's only 1,116, and therefore it's lower than expected. And pedestrian and footbridge D is very similar. That hasn't exceeded the forecast utilization rate. Yes, we did carry out some observation, but then we haven't, even without the traffic survey, we still have been doing observation. And if there is a need for further adjustment or fine-tuning, we'll do so.
Mr. Long, Chairman, I feel reassured. I think I've answered all the, I've asked all the questions. Ms. Eunice Yong, Chair, also on lifts. For other questions, other members have asked them on my behalf about footbridge A and its lift. According to the department, the period of suspension was longer because of high utilization, because of high frequency of use, insufficient spare parts. So may I know more about the maintenance contracts? Are they renewed once every few years? Now, in the past, you did not envisage high utilization, but what about the upcoming cycle? When will you next renew the contract, and will you include, will you provide more resources to support the next contract so as to boost service standard. Because in terms of manpower and procurement fees for spare parts, this will jack up the contract sum. So when is the next cycle of renewal? Are you going to implement the relevant measures? Secretary, Mr. Pang can elucidate on the next service contract. Each contract has a term of 3 to 3.5 years, but we feel that it is not necessary to enhance our services only when the next renewal is up. In fact, as explained, we're going to enhance our service in 6 major directions. We're going to enhance supervision. We're going to deploy technology to monitor the operation of lifts. We're also going to harness technology to gauge the status of lifts, whether maintenance is needed. We will also increase the inventory of spare parts so as to enhance safety and reliability of our lifts. What we're now working on is ensuring stringent monitoring so as to enhance service quality continuously. About handling complaints, you mentioned that you've already implemented enhancement measures even before the contract is renewed. But as far as complaints are concerned, are you going to include them as indicators, say, upon receipt of a complaint, if a repairman can be dispatched within 30 minutes or an hour or so? Will you include similar requirements in the contract that is about handling inquiries, complaints, and dispatching staff on scene? Now, as stated in Table 7, 67% of lifts were suspended for 6 minutes to 3 hours. That's in terms of lift incidents. In other words, repair could be completed within 3 hours in lift incidents. That includes the time for the contracted staff to go from his workshop or station to the lift in question, the time needed for repair, testing, and recommissioning. 3 hours is a reasonable period in our view. And the requirement of 3 hours is acceptable. About dispatching staff to the scene, our requirement is that in a case of somebody trapped in the lift, the staff should arrive on scene within 30 minutes or otherwise 1 hour. Again, the response time and the time for handling complaints or inquiries are reasonable. Apart from stepping up our monitoring effort, we also strive to reduce the number of lift incidents. This is our way forward. No other questions, Chair. Does any other member wish to put questions about this chapter? Mr. Wong. It seems that our public hearing on this chapter, Anderson Road Project, is drawing to a close. Anything else you wish to say? I think this report and this review will serve as an important reference to future projects. We want to find out the cause of problems to prevent a recurrence of problems in future projects. Throughout the public hearing, I heard Mr. Fong explain how technologies are employed and management is enhanced. In particular, I'd like to put in a good word for the Director of Electrical and Mechanical Services. Mr. Pang has prepared amply, and he has also set out in detail point by point in answering my question. Hence, we know that a series of measures have been implemented after a spate of lift suspensions incidents to improve services in order to better serve the public, and I appreciate that. Anything to add, Secretary? Well, I'd like to take this occasion to thank members, the Director of Audits, and my colleagues. Of course, I would also like to thank the whole team for helping us throughout the process in reviewing the arrangements, and I thank Mr. Wong, and I think it is of utmost importance that we identify problems and make improvements for the benefit of government departments, and we'll strive to make improvements in the future. Anything else you'd like to add, Director of Audit? No? If there are no further comments, then that's the end of the public hearing of Chapter 3 of Report Number 78, and that also concludes today's meeting. Would the administration please give us supplementary papers and replies, and we'll prepare a report. Thank you, members and government officials.